Well, it is a privilege to be here tonight to represent the Joseph Smith Papers and to introduce Robin and Royal to you. The day that the church was organized, the Lord declared, "Behold, there shall be a record kept among you." And the early saints took that commission seriously. And our mandate at the Joseph Smith Papers is to publish a comprehensive edition of everything that Joseph Smith wrote, that was written to him, minutes of meetings he attended, legal cases he was involved with, a comprehensive edition of the documentary record that was left behind. It's a privilege to be here tonight to celebrate the publication of our 11th volume, the third volume in the Revelations and Translation series, the printer's manuscript of the Book of Mormon. It's a particularly exciting volume because of the beautiful photographs of each page of the printer's manuscript, because of what it says about our collaboration with the community of Christ who owns the printer's manuscript, and because of the additional insight it gives into the translation process with the publication of an image of the seer stone that Joseph Smith used. I want to say just a couple of things about what is upcoming in the Joseph Smith Papers, hopefully to get you a little bit excited. With the publication of this book in August, and over the next year, from now until next September, we'll publish an additional four important books in the Joseph Smith Papers and related series. The first coming in November will be the final volume of Joseph Smith's journals, covering the last 18 months of his life, including journals kept at Carthage, Illinois. It will be a landmark publication. And then in next March, a documentary history of the Relief Society for its first 50 years, including the minutes of the Nauvoo Relief Society and the sermons that Joseph and Emma and others gave to that group. That same month, we'll publish the fourth volume in our document series covering 1834 and 1835, and then in September, the minutes of the Council of 50, the organization that Joseph Smith set up a few months before his death. So we're excited about what's been published, what's upcoming. We're particularly grateful to our hosts here tonight, to the Willis Institute, the Willis Center, the Religious Studies Center, and BYU Studies. And we're excited to hear from Royal Skousen, and second from Robin Jensen. The title of their remarks, "These were days never to be forgotten, the witnesses to the coming forth of the Book of Mormon." Royal is a professor of linguistics and English language here at BYU. He's been the editor of the Book of Mormon Critical Text Project since 1988. In 2001, he published with Farms and BYU volumes 1 and 2 of that series, transcripts of the two Book of Mormon manuscripts. Then from 2004 to 2009, the 6 parts of volume 4 of the critical text, analysis of textual variants of the Book of Mormon. In 2009, he published with Yale University Press the culmination of his critical text work, The Book of Mormon, The Earliest Text. We've been really grateful that he would collaborate with us at the Joseph Smith Papers on the third volume in the Revelation series. After Royal, we'll hear from Robin Scott Jensen. He's the associate managing historian and project archivist for the Joseph Smith Papers and the co-editor of the first 3 volumes in the Revelations and Translation series. Nobody whom I have ever met loves documents as much as Robin does. And I think you'll sense his enthusiasm here tonight. He specializes in document and transcription analysis. He holds degrees from Brigham Young University and from the University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee. Like Jack mentioned, after their talks, there will be an opportunity for questions and answers. So please hold your questions then, and we'll look forward to hearing their responses. Royal.
Well, this evening, I'm going to be talking about a certain witness of the Book of Mormon, namely this manuscript. Robin will be talking about people that were involved In the manuscript and the preservation of it and so forth. And so I want to concentrate on this actual book or these two books that have been produced and what it means. So there are these slides. We're going to see a few of these things. And this is a part of the Book of Mormon Critical Text Project. One of the things that I want to announce this evening is the following. In the beginning, the Book of Mormon Critical Text Project was an independent one associated with the Foundation for Ancient Research in Mormon Studies, FARMS. But in 2001, it became a part of BYU. By legal agreement last week with BYU on August the 31st, the Critical Text Project will no longer be officially associated with the Maxwell Institute, but will be housed under BYU Studies. The agreement restores the independence of the project and will facilitate the prompt and orderly completion of the project. Electronic texts of the project will be jointly published by BYU Studies and the Interpreter Foundation. So here we have many of you have seen the actual two books that have been published. This is in the third in the Revelations and Translations series, Printer's Manuscript of the Book of Mormon. There's another important volume that will be coming out, and this is the original manuscript of the Book of Mormon. It's a very fitting thing when this is complete, when both the original and the printer's manuscript will be available in photographs plus transcript. We have been talking quite a bit about the cooperation between the Community of Christ, formerly the RLDS Church, and our church. And in a sense, what will be, I think, even more appropriate is ultimately the publication of the original manuscript. We only have 28% of it. This is the manuscript that the scribes wrote down as Joseph Smith gave the text, dictated it. We have only 28%. 25 of the 28% is owned by our church in the church archives. So in a sense, the original manuscript is our manuscript. The printer's manuscript is owned by the Community of Christ, the Reorganized Latter-day Saint Church, and in a sense, that's their manuscript, we could say. By having both of them published, we truly have a joint presentation of the text of the Book of Mormon. And I have continually emphasized this as an important aspect to what's being done here. Well, what is new in the Joseph Smith Papers printer's manuscript? Well, what's really new are the color photographs. In fact, photographs available to everyone and anyone. On any given open page spread, you will see on the left the photograph. On the right, you will see what's called a facsimile transcript. This is an attempt to put in type, letter for letter, what's on the manuscript. Helps you read it. It does involve interpretation sometimes. And so where there are issues, you can read the transcript. You can read the transcript that I published in 2001, which forms the basis for this particular one. And you can look at the photographs. It's the photographs that really is a big step forward in providing this information for everyone. So, why the printer's manuscript? We know that it's a copy they made of the original manuscript. So, is it just another copy? Well, the answer is no, it is not just another copy. It is a unique copy, the only complete copy of the original manuscript. And we only have 28% of the original. So what this means is that for 72% of the Book of Mormon text, what we read today, we have to rely on what it says in the printer's manuscript. And there are some differences. So when I was doing my work on attempting to recover the original text based on the earliest sources, which would be the original manuscript, the printer's manuscript, the 1830 edition, those are the chief sources, I prepared six books published from 2004 to 2009, Matt mentioned them, Analysis of Textual Variants. And as this was coming to an end, I took the results of that and constructed the earliest text of the Book of Mormon and published it with Yale. And so that's been available now for about over 5 years. It gives the text based on these sources and interpretation as well as what it actually read, we hope, in interpreting what Joseph Smith received in the instrument that he used when he received the text and then read it to his scribes. One of the important things is that there are 606 new readings that have never appeared in any standard print edition of the Book of Mormon in the Yale text. And you can see the importance here of the sources. 216 come from the original. Only 28% of the text, but 216 come from the original. This means that those 216 were changed accidentally, for the most part, by Oliver and the other scribes when they made the copy, the printer's manuscript. Because the printer's manuscript is what they're going to take to the printer, basically. However, in the Yale text, there are 187 changes that come from the printer's manuscript, where we don't have the original. And this is even though the original or the printer's photographs have been available. In the careful study of the printers, we have discovered additional changes, quite a few. There are 88 changes that come from both the original and the printers. That means they agree. It means the 1830, for the most part, is the one that's different. And there are actually two changes in the title page that come from multiple copies that were made of the title page. We wish that instead of one copy, the printer's manuscript, we'd made a few more. If you're going to lose the original, it's good to have lots of copies. Okay. So the printer's manuscript is the copy made of the original. We only have 28% of the original because Joseph Smith put it in the cornerstone of the Nauvoo house. This is something you should not do. But Joseph thought he was trying to preserve, I think he thought he would preserve the manuscript to save it. But the seal broke, water got in, mold started to eat it away. Probably mold ate 70% and water damage just made it, most of it unusable. Louis Biedemann, who took it out, gave it chiefly to LDS people. And that's why most of it is in the church archives. But they made the copy, the printer's manuscript, because Joseph wanted them to take the printers to the press and leave the original back at home. He learned by the 116 pages that you needed backup, you need a copy. And so he made sure they weren't just going to take in the only copy to the press. We have discovered, okay, it was made from August 1829 through, it appears, January of 1830. They did not sit down at one big transcribing session and do it all. They did it bit by bit as the printer needed a copy. They actually got ahead. We can tell maybe about a month's worth. They were moving ahead of the press. Turns out, though, that the printer's manuscript was used for typesetting only 5/6 of the 1830 edition. 1/6 is actually set from the original. And we're going to look at why that might have occurred. When we look at the manuscript, we will see, in addition to what the scribe, the printers, what he copied, usually it was Oliver, but you will also see the 1830 printers' punctuation marks, usually in pencil, and they're on about one-third of the sheets. So John Gilbert, the typesetter, will mark the manuscript about one-third of the time in advance of the typesetting. But two-thirds of the time, he's going to just wing it and do it, apparently, as he's setting the type. And if any of you have ever looked at the structure of Book of Mormon sentences, you'll realize this was an incredible feat to be able to punctuate the text pretty well, too. Because the punctuation in our current text is essentially John Gilbert's. There's been some adjustments, particularly by Brother Talmage, 1920 edition, but not a lot. So we have really a pretty good punctuation. Well, the other marking up of the printer's manuscript is by Joseph Smith. And it was for the second edition. He was going through the text and making grammatical changes, changing the non-standard English, for the most part, into standard English. And so he will mark up the manuscript in heavy black ink. And apparently Oliver Cowdery was working with him and using an 1830 copy, we don't have this copy, but using it to mark the changes as well and a few more, because Joseph didn't put them all into the printer's manuscript. It was that copy, that 1830 copy, though, that the typesetter used for the 37 edition. They didn't reset the type looking at the manuscript, except maybe to check things, but they set the type actually from the 1830. You always do this. You don't want to set type from a manuscript. So you set it from a printed version if you have it, and they did in 37. Okay, so we will see this. Let's have a look. So this is the very first page of the printer's manuscript, and it's written in Oliver Cowdery's hand, and at the bottom we have 1.5 lines missing, and on the other side, they're going to write on both sides of the leaf, there will be 1.5 lines missing. The text was curling up, apparently, and this was the very first page, and it was on top, and it kept getting hit. And we have photographs from 1923, reverse black and white, where we can actually read a little bit more of it. So one of them is reproduced in the Joseph Smith, in this volume, the Joseph Smith Papers volume, and apparently it's all online. All the pages, the 1923. And it's nice to see the reverse black and white. You can really see the text. It shows up very nicely. Okay, so this is a blown up version from the middle of that, and I want to show you a few things here. So here's Oliver. He's copying from the original. We don't have this part of the original, the very first part of it, but he missed the words first year of the. He just wrote commencement of the reign of Zedekiah, king of Judah. So he caught it and inserted it probably almost immediately. He made a mistake, and he wrote of, and then he corrects it. He erased it with, I think in this case, there's some fiber. He used the pen knife to scrape it. He wrote or. That he wrote, he corrects it with the. So he's trying his best to get this down the way the original read. As far as we can tell, it's right. Here's the printer. Right here, you see this capital P in pencil, and the printer will decide the punctuation. The original chapters, which happen to be about twice as long, if you go look at a facsimile 1830 edition, you'll see the chapters are longer. They're based on narration. A whole discourse will be one chapter. The story of going to get the plates from Laban is one whole chapter. And it's written in the manuscript as one big paragraph. There's no punctuation originally. There's no paragraphing. There's no verses. Just one big sentence. Okay, one final thing here. Joseph Smith. There it is, that very heavy black ink. He corrects the grammar here from to be to is. And you will find this throughout the manuscript. Joseph is correcting grammar. Okay. So here is the first facsimile transcript I did back about 2000 or so. And a facsimile transcript, as you can see, is you put in type what's on the manuscript, you interpret things. And this isn't the final version I ended up with, but I just put it up here, and you can see Joseph Smith's is in bold because it was darker. Underlining for the typesetter, we can show in the new version, we don't have to do things like this, we can show it better with different colored ink in the printing process. So that's a nice way to show some of this. And these are the corrections, and some of it's missing, and we devised a very nifty way to do this too. Well, you just have to go look. Okay. So this is a page from the large Isaiah portion. And John Gilbert said, after a few days of working on this, I asked them, can I take the manuscript home to punctuate it? And they finally gave him permission to do it. Apparently, though, it wasn't just a few days. It would have been a few weeks, like 6 weeks into the process, because this is in 2 Nephi. It's the Isaiah portion. And he's having trouble punctuating it. And he really wants to use his Bible. So he takes it home, and he now is at home, and he uses ink. When he's in the shop, he uses pencil, which is good practice, not to mess with ink marking up a manuscript. But when he gets at home, he uses ink, and it's all black here, all these marks. And this is the punctuation from the King James Bible at the time. He even made a few corrections, though, because the scribe of the original had misheard "at" as "that" and had written "that," and it was copied into the printers that way. And he noticed in his Bible it was "at," so he corrects it. And it is a correct change. It was "at," I think, not "that." That doesn't really make sense. Well, you can see this is, and he did this apparently for 2 nights only. And then he took it back, and he hadn't done all of Isaiah, but he got through it. They just had to keep moving. This is a very important one at the beginning of the Book of Mosiah. We don't have the original here. And we're going to look at the top portion of it. It's in Oliver's hand. This is the beginning of the Book of Mosiah. But you see almost immediately it isn't. So there was originally, he wrote chapter 3, and he put the 3 in heavier ink. So he's apparently adding this. And the text he's looking at, the original, would have had chapter and 3 added. When Joseph was dictating, he apparently saw something that said end of the chapter, but there's no word chapter. So he just told the scribe, write chapter. No numbers, just write chapter. So the word chapter is written by Oliver in the same ink in the original where we have it. Then later, Oliver's going to go in and put numbers in, or other scribes. Sometimes they put the wrong number in. And here he put chapter 3, and then he realized, wait a minute, we got a problem. This is where we have the going from the small plates or something like it, or the large plates to the small plates, and we have part of it missing because it was in the 116 pages. So apparently Joseph's down in Pennsylvania. So he's deciding this will be the beginning of Mosiah. And he crosses out the 3 and makes it a 1. He inserts the Book of Mosiah. But it really can't be the beginning of the true Book of Mosiah because it doesn't begin with Mosiah. It's Benjamin. And Book of Mormon books begin with the person that's first, the name. So what we really apparently have here is the idea that this is the beginning of the original third chapter of the Book of Mosiah. The first two are missing. And what we definitely, it seems we have, is the first chapter is missing and part of the second. It was probably in the 116 pages. Joseph just said it was the book of Lehi, but there were probably a little bit of the beginning of Mosiah, and so it's lost too. And it may be that the end of the words of Mormon, maybe from verse 12 or 13 on, is actually part of the second chapter of the original Mosiah. We don't know for sure. There's been an article written by Lyons and Minson in BYU Studies about this possibility. But we see it here. Something took place. An intrusion, so to speak, where Oliver is attempting to get it fixed up. But the Book of Benjamin begins in the middle of things. Well, Book of Benjamin. Book of Mosiah begins in the middle of things. And it doesn't have a summary like other books. It's named after Mosiah, which would have been his father. So probably chapter 1 was about Mosiah leaving the land of Nephi, finding the people of Zarahemla. Chapter 2 is probably the reign of Benjamin and the difficulties he had in his reign. And then chapter 3 is he's going to turn it over, the reign to Mosiah. So it's very interesting to see how Oliver dealt with this. We wish we had the original here, but it's gone. Okay. So this is in words what I've just said, and it just summarizes it. So this is a page that the Community of Christ loves to put on display because it's the only page which has all the scribes together. So this is an unknown scribe too, and it turns out this scribe, you know, you look at it at first, you think, oh, this looks really nice, but when you try and transcribe it, you discover this is awful, because you can't tell vowels and M and N's and so forth, and when you have to calculate how long it takes you to transcribe a page by a certain scribe, that's how. If it's short, they're a good scribe. If they're bad, it takes a long time. This guy takes a long time. But one of the interesting things I've found is this guy spells very well. He's got good spelling. He's a first-class speller. His spellings agree with the typesetters. Oliver makes quite a few errors. He's a second-rate speller. And then there are third-rate spellers, two Whitmers in the original, and this one. This is Hiram Smith with his capital D's everywhere. And the typesetter is going in and already interpreters misspelled, so he spells it for him, corrects it in pencil. This is Hiram Smith. When he copied it, he left out a large group here. And both begin with neither, if I recall. And so Oliver corrects it, so we've got Oliver on here. Hiram put chapter 14th, but it wasn't. It wasn't his fault, because earlier ones had messed it up. The typesetter made it chapter 13, so the numbers are being added. And then we have Joseph Smith making the corrections, mostly which to who and was to were. In them days, not in them days, but they was yet wroth, it would be changed to they were yet wroth. And all the witches that refer to people, those will be changed by Joseph. It's King James language, but it's in there. So there we see all the scribes that worked on it. It's a very nice page. It's the only one that's got them all together. So Scribe 2 does about 10% of the printer's manuscript. And Hiram does less than 0.5%. He takes over for this scribe, too, who's taking over for Oliver. Oliver does 80, Yes, and almost 90. No, maybe it's 50. I have to look at mine. I've got the numbers off, but it's in that area, 80 to 85, 90% all over. Okay, so this, we know when this took place, when this was copied. And we'll look at the top of it. So Oliver Cowdery, on November the 6th, 1829, wrote a letter to Joseph Smith saying, "We have gotten up to the place where the commandment, where Alma gives the commandment to his sons." And he uses the singular in the letter. And he had actually written that. See, this was originally commandment. That S is in blue ink. And he apparently that night had written or a chapter and the commandment of Alma to his son Helaman, and then he quit and he wrote the letter to Joseph. But when he came back, he was using blue ink at first, and he lines rather roughly the rest of the page in blue ink. He corrects this because the original has S, and then he puts in the chapter number in blue. When I saw this in Independence, looking at the real manuscript, I was shocked because I thought it was the same black ink. So this showed me really very clear evidence the chapter numbers are being added. And it also tied in, that shows there, this is where they are, Alma, what, 36? Yeah, on November the 6th. They're about a month ahead, I think, of the printer, where the printer would have been. Okay. So this is a typical leaf that comes into the printer, at least in many parts, and he will cut it up. He took a knife and just cut along the fold of this. It was a larger sheet folded, and he cut it here. Apparently, so either two different people setting type or someone proofing something and typesetting another. And later, they didn't use Scotch tape, we're grateful, but they didn't use any tape or any, they used pins to hold this together, and you can see the stains, the iron in the pins that were holding this together for decades. So we know that when it went into the typesetter, this thing could be really messed up. I mean, you know, physically taken apart, and they were going to set the type, and that's what's important. We're grateful they saved the printer's manuscript. But here is something. There are four gatherings. Gatherings are a group of sheets that are folded and lined, and they write the text on them, and they'd stitch them together and then take them in to the printer. There are four gatherings in the printer's manuscript that were never taken into the printer's shop. There's no punctuation marks. They were kept together with the threads, the yarn that they put in here, stains it, because it's there till the early 1900s. And only these four gatherings are like this. So this means this is not being used by the printer. When we have fragments of the original, this is from Helaman 13 through the end of Mormon, fragments of the original show the pencil marks of the typesetter. The church has a fragment from 3 Nephi 26:27. It's got the pencil marks of John Gilbert all over it. And we found it in the Wilford Wood fragments, 2% of the text in the Helaman portions in 3 Nephi. So they're taking in the original. Why? Well, when I first discovered this, for 20 years, I espoused the view, the only thing I could think of is they fell behind in the copy work. Now, there's a little bit of a conspiracy if you start thinking about this. So Joseph's down in New York, and they're up there, and they're three-fourths the way through, and they haven't had any problem. You can just see the brethren saying, well, we can't keep up. We can't sit there in the press waiting for us. We'll just take in the original. Well, I believe this theory is wrong. It's wrong. And we now, there was an article again in BYU Studies, which dealt with this supposed attempt by Joseph Smith. This is how David Whitmer messed it up, I think, going to Canada to try and sell the Book of Mormon during this time period. But what appears to have really happened was that they became afraid that there wasn't copyright protection for the Book of Mormon in the British realm in Canada. And there was a guy, Abner Cole, who had been publishing, he'd been working Sundays in the print shop and saw all these sheets piled up and says, oh, this is really interesting. I'm gonna put it in my newspaper. So he printed two issues with parts of First Nephi, and then he printed part of Alma. And he's the first publisher of the Book of Mormon. And when Joseph, they tried to stop him, he refused. They got Joseph up from Susquehanna, and he had to use the law to stop Abner Cole. But what I think became the concern, maybe Abner Cole even threatened this, you know, we don't know, but he could have said, well, I can go 100 miles north and publish this thing. So what they did was, at the end of January, they finished up making the copy. They worked double, the unknown scribe two, and Oliver Cowdery. Oliver will go to Ether and finish it, and scribe two will go all the way through Mormon. The manuscript is now complete. They have two complete copies. They take the printers to Canada. Oliver Cowdery took it, Hiram Page, two other brethren. They went in the middle of winter. They crossed the lake on its ice. They tried for some time. They came back a month later. They weren't successful. But it turned out they didn't have to be. No one really published it. But this was a real attempt, and Joseph would have known about it. He gave the approval, and they took it up, and they tried to do this. In the meantime, they took in the original to the typesetter. They never told him. He said later, oh, I only thought there was one copy. So he set from the original. This is very good. They should have set the whole thing from the original, not the copy, because Oliver makes about three changes per manuscript page, most of them innocuous. An extra delete of the, you know, things like this. But sometimes he changes the meaning slightly. Three per page. The typesetter is about as good. Three per page. So how many do you have all together? Six per page. But if you take in the original, you'll get three. So actually, from Helaman 13 through the end of Mormon, we have a better text because the original was taken in. But when they got back with the printers, they started taking the printers in to the typesetter. And so from Ether on, it's back to that. Okay, but you can see here, it's really very nicely done. And this is in text, what I've just been saying. And there's something on the Mormon interpreter which goes through my arguments for why they didn't fall behind. They knew what they were doing. And Joseph knew too. This is the end of Mormon. This is the unknown scribe. Notice he leaves a whole page blank. This is because Oliver has jumped ahead and has already done Ether, so you don't need to copy that again. They don't do this normally because that paper costs money. And they don't have much money. Notice they really write to the edge and everything. Okay. This is George Schweik, the grandson of David Whitmer. The manuscript was in Oliver's hands when he left the church in 1838. He had been basically the one in charge of setting the type for the 1837. He had the manuscript with Joseph Smith's markings. And when he left the church, he took the manuscript. He kept it. He had it in his possession. When he died in 1850, it went to his brother-in-law. It was David Whitmer, one of the three witnesses. David Whitmer showed it to people, and Robin will tell us about these experiences. And in 88, Whitmer dies, and so ultimately his grandson is given possession of it. He sells it in 1903 to the RLDS Church. And here he is. And when I worked on my initial transcript, the RLDS Church sent me this big black and white copy. And there it is, and you'll see on top of it an actual 1830 to give you an idea of the size difference. This is the manuscript photographed earlier. There's one that the Church News put in of an earlier one too, and you can see the manuscript. They also have the two loose leaves on top, and then the actual manuscript begins. In April of 1991, my wife and I went back to Independence. I asked if I could check my transcript against the actual manuscript. And this caused a bureaucratic nightmare for a while. I didn't know anything about it. It was really good that I didn't. But the RLDS decided, okay, he's doing his scholarly work. We're going to let him have access to it, to actually work on the manuscript, comparing it with his transcript. They took it out of the bank vault in Kansas City and brought it to their, where they had their archives at the time. And so there's the actual manuscript, the actual leaves, and there's my transcript. And I thought I could do it in a week to check my transcript. And of course, everything I do in the Book of Mormon takes me always longer. And so I got them to agree to do it for 2 weeks. And at the end, I was running out of time, and so I got a chest clock from the LDS people we were staying with, and I set 7 minutes for each page. Well, you can see I was cutting corners, but there's the chest clock, and there's my transcript. There's the actual printer's manuscript. And so I realized I need some photographs in color. And 1.5 years later, October 1992, my brother, Nevin Skousen, he's now deceased, but he was a professional photographer. He went back, and we made color photographs and two prints, one for the RLDS Church, still the RLDS Church, and for me, that we can work off of. Color makes a real difference. And then in June of 1994, I wanted to check all the papers of the manuscript. Were they the same or were they different? The printers, and I had 2% of fragments from the Wilford Wood family that I had possession of, some of the fragments. The church had its 25% with paper types from fragments of those, and the RLDS had the printer's manuscript. This is one of the great ecumenical moments. And we are working there with the actual manuscript. I think my wife is holding it. But there's Ron Romig, the archivist for the RLDS Church, my wife, me, and Robert Espinoza, head of conservation at the BYU Library, a Catholic. And we are all working on trying to determine whether the papers are the same or different. There's any overlap or anything. It turns out they're all different. But we know that now. And Brian Reeves, who, I don't know who actually carried the fragments from Salt Lake, because maybe Rick Turley can tell us. He came, and what's his name?
I carried him.
You carried him. Okay. I went down there just expecting Brian Reeves to be there, and here's a whole committee from Salt Lake bringing the fragments. And what it really means is our church, their church, and the Wilford Wood family were all cooperating together to do this. To me, this was a very important moment in the history of our churches. So, in the late 1990s, our church agreed to conserve the manuscript. When I worked on it, little bits would just fall off. You know, you start to worry. It's fragmenting. And so it was washed. They checked it before doing this to make sure the ink just didn't float off the document. And they needed to deacidify And they're going to put it under Mylar, and ultimately that's how it will look. And here are, this was originally an open sheet. This is the first page. You can see the 1.5 missing. This is page 24 in the manuscript on the other side. And this is the way it is today. It's in Mylar, no longer folded. It isn't the same feeling document, but it is preserved. The text is preserved. To me, this is what's really important. So even if the photographs fail us and we got to go look at the actual manuscript, we can. And that's an important thing, I think. Well, one of the things that I am impressed with all of this, is that the Book of Mormon is for the whole world. Not, we sometimes think it's our book, but it's actually for everyone. There are Protestants who are even getting excited about the Book of Mormon. We wish the Community of Christ were more excited. But they have done a wonderful job preserving this and allowing our church to help them do it. And I'm grateful for it. Thank you.
Okay, very good to be with you tonight. I'm grateful for this chance to participate on this volume with Royal Skousen. It's been an actual great privilege to work with Royal. He's a wonderful scholar, and I've learned a lot. So my background is from the Joseph Smith Papers Project, documentary editing project. I ask all sorts of questions about manuscripts. Questions many would not ask. Sometimes I get really excited about a particular find that I've made, and I rush home to tell my family, and they get they roll their eyes, wondering why that was exciting. But they just don't see the light. It's truly exciting. But when I'm looking at documents, I ask some questions. These are basic questions to any historians, but they're questions about the creation of those documents. Who created it? Why did they create it? What was the purpose for that creation? In my archival background, archivists tend to talk about the value of a document. There's a primary value of a document. That's the purpose that it was originally created. And then there's secondary values of documents. So I'm going to talk a little bit today about the witnesses to the Book of Mormon and their statements. They left statements about the coming forth of the Book of Mormon, and I would like to treat those as documents, questions that we can ask those statements, those individuals who made these statements. As Royal has given us a wonderful presentation, the printer's manuscript is our best witness to the coming forth of the printer's manuscript of the Book of Mormon. We have this this document that is a contemporary document. Its primary value, however, was finished in March of 1830. As a printer's copy, it was no longer needed after the first edition of the Book of Mormon was published. So when I look at this document, I actually marveled that it remained, that people kept hold of it. Royal hinted at this. It's very common for printers to throw away manuscripts once something is printed. We're grateful that this did not happen. So my question is, why did Joseph Smith keep a hold of this manuscript? He used it again in 1837 for the second edition of the Book of Mormon, but I think there was other reasons why Joseph Smith maintained possession of this manuscript. And then my next question is, why did Oliver Cowdery end up with the manuscript? Joseph Smith kept this manuscript from 1830 to 1837. Why did he then turn it over to Oliver Cowdery? And what did Oliver Cowdery feel about this manuscript? Did he feel fondly about this manuscript? Did he recall the wonderful days of translating? Was this a symbol of his effort in bringing forth the Book of Mormon? Did it remind him of the many hand cramps that he had while copying the Book of Mormon. We don't know. But what we do know is that Oliver Cowdery felt a bond enough to keep this manuscript throughout his life. He kept this manuscript and then turned it over to his brother-in-law just before he died, as Royal has mentioned. And David Whitmer were quite clear. He left statements as to what he felt of this manuscript. He saw this manuscript, he saw this as a sacred responsibility. He knew that the Lord wanted him to keep this manuscript safe. There were individuals who offered him money for the manuscript, and he turned them down. He would not sell the manuscript. He felt that this was an important religious symbol. This was an important artifact for him. He thought that this was truly a sacred artifact. His family, later, not so much. He gave it to his son and then his grandson, and his grandson began to see this as financial value. He saw the Book of Mormon as something that perhaps he could get some money from. So George Schweik sold it to the RLDS Church. The RLDS Church recognized it for what it was, a wonderful historic and religious artifact. And then, of course, later individuals had value placed upon this manuscript. We often talk, or some people talk about the printer's manuscript being offered to the LDS Church. Joseph F. Smith was offered the printer's manuscript. He turned it down. For Joseph F. Smith, he saw in this manuscript a version, another version of the Book of Mormon. And he felt that the value for that was not as great as we would fill it as. Joseph F. Smith said, there are multiple versions. We don't necessarily need this one. Luckily, we've mentioned, the RLDS Church found great value in this, and they've preserved it. They've been careful custodians, careful stewards of this manuscript to the present day. And of course, each of these generations, each of these individuals who have possessed this manuscript, give us a glimpse into their treatment of the manuscript, their value placed upon this manuscript. We, in essence, as we take a generational approach to the way individuals treated the Book of Mormon, and the manuscripts and the other artifacts, we understand the values, the worldviews, and the principles that they felt important in maintaining this record. And of course, that continues today. There's a reason why the Book of Mormon manuscript has been published by the Joseph Smith Papers. There is still lasting value in this manuscript. We feel that for both scholars and members of the church, there is importance in this text. And so, what happens when we take a look at this generational approach to the documents, to the statements of the coming forth of the Book of Mormon? I'm going to spend just a little bit of time talking about some stories, talking about some individuals who witnessed the coming forth of the Book of Mormon. And I would argue that when we analyze this secondary value of individuals, when we look at the individuals and why they left statements about their experiences for the Book of Mormon, we can understand how early Latter-day Saints and subsequent generations treated the Book of Mormon. We can understand the role of the Book of Mormon in early church practice, worship, and subsequent members and scholars. Now, I want to begin with a caution. Historians have a very strong bias towards the written record. We spend all our days in archives reading sources. And of course, we're going to gravitate towards those sources. I think one of the first things we need to remember is that many of the witnesses to the coming forth of the Book of Mormon did not leave satisfactory records. In fact, some left no records at all. We only know of their experiences from second or third or fourth hand. But I would argue that as historians and as scholars, we need to dig for these voices. Because I think when we uncover the voiceless, when we uncover the individuals who played a role in the coming forth of the Book of Mormon, we can add greater appreciation to how the early church treated the Book of Mormon. As an example, Emma Smith, of course, is a prominent figure of early church history. Joseph Smith relied heavily upon Emma. She's one of the few women to receive be mentioned in the Doctrine and Covenants. She's the recipient of Section 25, of course. Her role in the coming forth of the Book of Mormon is important. And I would argue that we've lost some of it, in fact. Emma Smith was scribe for much of the early portion of the Book of Mormon. When we think of Emma's contribution, maybe we think of some of the mundane tasks she was doing. Someone, of course, had to cook for Joseph and Oliver as they were working on the printer or on the Book of Mormon translation. Someone had to clean the house. Someone had to upkeep the home. This, of course, was done by Emma and other individuals assisting. But Emma was a scribe. She was a scribe to the Book of Mormon, and her contribution was important. She worked tireless in bringing forth this early portion of the manuscript. Well, at the same time, she is expecting, pregnant with their first child. Joseph and Emma were recently married. They were pregnant, presumably excited for the addition of, or the growth of their family. And of course, we know the story. Martin Harris became excited. He wanted to show this early portion of the manuscript to family friends. He takes it up to Palmyra area, and Joseph and Emma don't hear from him. And they have this child who is essentially a stillbirth. The child dies. And we have this loss. Emma, Joseph suffer this tremendous loss. And it's more than that. Emma is near death. She is described as being on her deathbed for quite a while. Joseph, as a dutiful husband, is waiting there. Finally, Emma convinces Joseph to go up to Palmyra and find out what happened to the manuscript. Well, Joseph goes up and, of course, finds that there's a second loss. And the manuscript is lost. He comes down heavy with this burden of loss, and we don't know the reaction. We don't understand the pain and the loss that Emma must have felt. She and Joseph worked hard to produce this manuscript, but we don't know. We don't have a record of Emma's reaction. But I believe that we have, if we suppose Joseph the prophet would have added comfort to Emma, he must have received a revelation. I believe that Joseph received a revelation for Emma. Where is that recorded in the Doctrine and Covenants? It's not. We have many revelations to Oliver Cowdery, to Martin Harris, to others. Where's the section in the Doctrine and Covenants giving comfort to Emma and Joseph for the loss of their child? It doesn't exist. It was not written down, or it was lost. So I would argue that this scene tells us a little bit about how Joseph recorded revelations, how he saw the institutional church versus his personal life. And I, as a historian, need to remember that if we follow the paper trail, sometimes we go down a certain path, ignoring other avenues of exploration. Emma is one of those witnesses to the coming forth of the Book of Mormon that should not be forgotten, that her story should be told. Understanding the context in which Joseph and Emma recorded documents helps us recover some of that. There are other witnesses to the coming forth of the Book of Mormon. During the publication process, as we've heard from Royal, Hiram, Oliver, others took portions of the manuscript into the printing office in Palmyra. A man by the name of John Gilbert set much of the type. We have several late reminiscences from John Gilbert. If we treat those reminiscences again as documents, as memories, as purposeful statements from Gilbert made later in his life, we have to ask ourselves why. Why did he make those statements? What purposes did he feel that would bring about? John Gilbert was not an enthusiastic supporter of Joseph Smith and his revelations. John Gilbert was excited about his role in the coming forth of the Book of Mormon. He was proud that he set the type for this Book of Mormon, but he was not a believer. He was a non-believer in the Book of Mormon. He was willing to entertain ideas of a more humanistic explanation of where the Book of Mormon came from. But I think it would be to our detriment to ignore his voice, not only in the sense of his voice as helping us reconstruct the events of the past, because he leaves a lot of statements that help us understand the publication process. But I think what's important is that to early individuals who experienced the Book of Mormon, it influenced both believers and non-believers. The Book of Mormon influenced non-believers in Palmyra. We find ourselves today, the Book of Mormon, as a very important book, not just for members of the Latter-day Saints, but for other individuals. The Book of Mormon, it could be argued, is a very influential book in American and world history. Many individuals have been influenced, and that ripple effect has influenced millions of people worldwide. So what do we understand about John Gilbert? Those non-Mormon, those non-believer individuals who confronted the Book of Mormon help us understand the Book of Mormon better. John Gilbert is an obvious example. He punctuated most of the Book of Mormon text. Now, as a reader, the punctuation matters. It helps us navigate the text. It helps us make sense of the text. We have got the Book of Mormon text, and we make sense of the Book of Mormon text through a filter of a non-believer. We understand the phrasing and the sentence structure and other grammatical elements of the text in some part due to a non-Mormon, a non-believer. And I think that that's a powerful metaphor, actually, for us understanding the Book of Mormon itself. The Book of Mormon can be read by non-believers. Non-believers can help us gain insight to the Book of Mormon. They read it in a different way that helps us make sense of this text that we're so familiar with. Now, and of course, there's John Gilbert in all his glory with his hair. I will end my remarks with David Whitmer. David Whitmer, of course, was a custodian of the printer's manuscript for some time. I mentioned that he felt it was his divine duty to keep track and protect this manuscript. Well, what was his view of the manuscript? How did he value the manuscript? He clearly saw it as a religious artifact. This was an important spiritual document for him. But for him, it was also a family heirloom. It was a family artifact. During one of his visits, he pointed to the string, the yarn that had bound the manuscript that Royal had pointed out. And he proudly proclaimed that this was his mother's yarn, that this belonged to his mother. And for me, that statement, that highlighting of the artifacts is testament that David Whitmer felt that his family had an important role in bringing forth the Book of Mormon. Mary Whitmer, Mary Musselman Whitmer, his mother, we have another story from her. She did not leave any statement. She did not leave any record. But we have two different accounts from David Whitmer and Mary's grandson about the story of Mary Whitmer. Of course, Joseph and Oliver and Emma moved from Harmony up to Fayette to live with the Whitmers to translate the Book of Mormon. This was a very trying time for the Whitmers. They had to host individuals who were not really carrying their weight. They were doing the Book of Mormon translation. They could not assist much in the farm work or the household duties. And so Mary, according to the account, Mary Whitmer was frustrated. She was annoyed at the amount of work she had to do. And the story goes, she went out she saw an angel. An angel came and essentially said, due to your trials, you need to see these plates to make you feel better about the situation. She was the first unofficial witness to the Book of Mormon. Her story was a powerful story for the Whitmer family. It helped solidify that family as important custodians for the manuscript, for the events surrounding the coming forth of the Book of Mormon. This may have been done to justify or further centralize the Whitmers in this event, but Mary's story was sacred to David and to her grandson. And so here we have David Whitmer seeing the Book of Mormon manuscript not just as a spiritual artifact, not just as a spiritual text, but as a family document, that this was a sacred responsibility for the Whitmer family. And so what does that tell us? It tells us that David Whitmer, despite his difficulties with Joseph later in his life, felt a sacred connection to this text. And I think that's best highlighted in a visit with George Buchanan. George Buchanan comes to visit David Whitmer. They clearly had ideological differences. They would not agree on certain things within the Mormon faith, but what brought them together? It was the Book of Mormon text. It was the early experiences of David Whitmer. For whatever reason, George Buchanan and David Whitmer could see past their differences and unify around the Book of Mormon text. And I've find that a good analogy for scholarship and members today. There are multiple approaches to the Book of Mormon. There's multiple directions in which we can study the Book of Mormon text. But what does unify us all in our devotion to and study of this text is the text itself. It brings multiple voices together. It helps us understand the value that we hold for the Book of Mormon. We have many secondary values to the Book of Mormon. Some, it might be purely academic. For some, it might be scripture. And for many of us, it's both. And I find that story with David Whitmer and George Buchanan inspiring. The Book of Mormon can and will continue to unify us as scholars and as members of the church. And that, to me, is the enduring value of the Book of Mormon. Thank you very much. I guess we'll field questions here, so yes. I'm sorry, what was the...
Where is the information, the quotes that the printer made?
So John Gilbert, actually Royal Skousen wrote an article about one of the statements of John Gilbert. Royal, where is that?
The most recent version with pictures and everything from the manuscript showing what he said is in the Journal of Book of Mormon Studies, published by the Maxwell Institute maybe 3 years ago, four. And he's 90 years old, and he writes this on his birthday, and I check what he says against the actual physical record, and he's almost always right on. Where he's off, you can see he usually goes from 90% to 100%. And it's a very good statement. And there are other statements. I think we record another letter he wrote to a Cobb guy, right, in Salt Lake. And they don't always agree, you know, precisely. And one thing we always, I think, is good to do when there is these records of what people say is to go actually look at the material evidence. Is it supportive? Is it not? Where is it disagree? And very often, you know, sometimes a witness is really bad. You know, the evidence just completely against what they've recalled. All the witnesses of the translation said that the scribe had to write it down precisely, correctly, everything spelled correctly. Could be no errors. This is not true. You just look at the original manuscript, you'll see it's just not true. So then you have to say, where are they getting this idea from? And there's a lot of things like this that you can't take things quite on face value. You've got to check them, and especially the material witnesses. That's why the manuscripts turn out to be really important.
In the back there.
The last 116 pages, how much was given to the scribe for those pages?
Well, I'm going to talk about this one because there are two people here, I think, that hold a different view that Emma did the majority. I don't think she did the majority. I think she did the beginning portion, her comments about the walls of Jerusalem and Sariah being mispronounced as Sarah by Joseph indicate very beginning portion of the 116 pages, the Book of Lehi. I think it's mostly Martin, and he was there for several months, and his wife's complaining, why aren't you up here on the farm doing your work? And I think if he hadn't been the majority scribe, he wouldn't have been allowed to even, I don't think he would even ask to have taken it. But since he was, and Joseph could see he was really dependent on Martin, and he wasn't depending on the Lord, he was depending on Martin, he was kept asking the Lord to take it. So I know that others have espoused other views, but I think it really only makes sense that Martin Harris is the main author, the scribe, for the 116 pages. Emma did the beginning portion. We also know that apparently she did a little bit after the loss, would have been in Mosiah. But we don't have any of it, of course.
Yeah, I'd only add to that without the manuscript, we don't know, of course, for sure.
Well, there are things that the photographs won't quite show. You'd have to shoot at a different angle sometimes to see certain things. I think whenever they set 11 to 13 lines of type in the composing stick, John Gilbert apparently took a pen knife and slashed where he was. And then he'd take that type and put it in the galley and then come back. Now, why I use the pen knife, who knows? But it's hard to see sometimes. Another one is, you know, there are things like they run out of ink with a quill, and you can see the imprint of the empty quill in the paper, and then he will redo it. I would say also the washing had some effect on the brilliancy of the ink. So the photographs I showed came from my brother's shooting, but the ones in the book aren't as vivid. And you have to finally decide what's more important. Are you going to preserve it so you can still read it, or are you going to let it deteriorate? So I think we made the right decision, but there are differences. I don't think there's much, though, in the manuscript that we need to actually go look at the real one for textual purposes. Even the things I mentioned here have to do with the typesetting and how the quill was used and things like that. So from the text point of view, I think what you have now is sufficient for working with the printer's manuscript.
So the question was about the stone published with the volumes of the Revelation and Translation series. That is the seer stone. It's often described as a chocolate-covered seer stone. We published this image in the Joseph Smith Papers volume because it has a solid provenance connected to Joseph Smith. That is seen as... Terms get a bit confusing. By 1832, the term Urim Thummim circulated, and it's referred to both the Nephite interpreters and to a seer stone, so a physical instrument used in the translation. So the stone that we've published was called the seer stone, but sometimes called the Urim Thummim.
Thank you. you mentioned that she herself did not make her own recording. How long after her experience were the recordings made, and how much of that time do you think affected the accuracy of the account?
Yeah, so the question was Mary Whitmer. She did not leave a statement, and so there's a question of how long after did her son and grandson make these statements. I should have come prepared with the exact date, but it's multiple decades after the translation. I believe David Whitmer, it's in the 70s or 80s.
And why do you think she chose not to leave a record of such a profound experience?
So that's actually not uncommon. It's quite possible that she left some sort of written statement, but this is the time in the early 19th century where women did not keep as close a record as men did often. They were seen, I think she did make a statement clearly in the way that women at the time did. She told her family about it. Whether it was written down, I probably not. So this matches more the context of record keeping at the time where we just don't have statements from women that often. I do believe that, I mean, you're asking an important question about the time after the fact, that there's clearly going to be some sort of influence upon the story with time. And I think that's where, as I talked about in my presentation, it's important to understand or to distinguish between actual events and how later generations viewed those events. So this story clearly meant something to Mary Whitmer. She passed it on to her family. It clearly meant something to David Whitmer, clearly meant something to her grandson. Whether those values are the same or not, we don't know. And that, I think, is where uncovering the values of subsequent generations is important.
Well, I want to say something. There's a problem, you know, with the Mary Whitmer statement, of course, because it is, you know, all the secondary. We have David Whitmer stating it. John Whitmer's son is the grandson. There is a third account. It is much later, dating from the 1950s through Christian Whitmer. I have published it on the Mormon Interpreter. There's several factors in the third account which make it sound actually more accurate. And one of the problems with the Mary Whitmer account by John, or not John's son, and by David, is that it is made out that she's just working hard. Well, I don't think that's a good enough reason to really show her the plates. I mean, Emma worked hard, never got to see the plates. But the third account says that she got mad because Joseph and Oliver, when they'd take a break, would go out and skip rocks on a pond. And here she was working all over the place, doing all the work, and she was irritated that they couldn't, if they wanted exercise, she had work they could do. And so she was going to have them thrown out, removed. And this, you know, there are a lot of males around there to protect them from others and so forth. So the account coming through, this comes through the Christian Whitmer line. It's a third one, and it gives that a very serious reason. And the angel Moroni telling her, I have asked the Lord whether you could see these or not. And they wanted to get, Moroni wanted her to have a really good reason for doing this work, and maybe to forgive Joseph and Oliver for skipping rocks. The skipping rocks is very important because this is what Martin Harris and Joseph did during the 116-page period. It's a similar, just sort of completely independent, which makes you think there is some legitimacy to this account. So I recommend you go look at the third account, because if Mary had gotten her way, they don't have a place to go to translate. And I think it was a much more serious crisis than just Mary working hard. This is the third account. They're all secondary. The one is dating from the 1950s. I give all the provenance of it. You know, it isn't much of a provenance. You may not like it, but it fits better. And I don't think it's constructed to fit. You know, it's off the wall. Well, okay. You can always still think about things. You know, he's putting the money up, and in fact, there's one thing we're still debating, or not debating about, but I guess we're still not sure how the full payment came about, and something we're investigating on this. But Grandin is the publisher in the sense that he's paying. I mean, until he gets payment, and he's putting out funds. As far as I know, he's not doing much. You know, it's Gilbert and the pressman, and they hire an extra pressman, and they mention some people helping with the typesetting and so forth. So, you know, I don't know that he was actively involved much in the actual physical production, but that's, I just don't see him showing up in the accounts.
You highlighted a second transcriber for the printers. Surely there's a short list of people that
yeah.
Do you have any ideas on that?
Well, I used to think it might be Martin Harris, but there's supposed to be larger accounts of his handwriting now than we've had before, so I'm not sure. I dismiss the Smith family member and a Whitmer family member simply because they are farm people, and I don't think they could be that good a speller. Now, Scribe 2 is not a good scribe. His hand, he's, you know, we love Oliver. Oliver's really clear, but he's not a particularly good speller. You may think so. You know, he was a school teacher, but so was Hiram. Hiram taught school too, and he was the worst scribe. So you can't go on that. But whoever it is a little bit better, I think, than we've thought. I thought at first this is a bad scribe, you know, and he was. But as I started the spelling study, we have Oliver misspells weapons this many times. He finally learns how to spell it two-thirds the way through the printer's manuscript because he's proofing. And Scribe 2 always spells it right. And this goes on all the time, always spells it right. So whoever this is, he knows, and I presume it's a he, but we only know if Emma is a female scribe, knows standard spelling.
We have time for one more question.
It's going to be at about, well, the manuscript, they are fool's cap. It's a size in my, I think you mentioned some sizes, don't you?
Yeah.
And it's in the volume. So you're getting about 1 1/3 pages of the 1830 from a manuscript page. So it would have been 116 times about 1 1/3, 4/3 to give whatever would have been the textual amount of what was there.
Okay, thank you very much.